Hi guys, welcome to GI Weekly episode 7. I'm on the sofa, but as you'll notice, John isn't with me, and that'll become apparent very soon. John is actually in London somewhere with Mr. Big himself, Paul Gilbert. He's doing a special interview with him, a bit of a rig rundown, some questions. So I'm going to hand over to John right now, and take it away, John.
So hey guys, we're on stage here at the garage in London with the one and only Pablo Gilberto, Paul Gilbert.
Hello, nice to be here. Thank you very much.
It's fantastic to have you. Well, it's fantastic for you to have us. Thanks so much to, you know, have us on stage with your guitar, your gear, everything good to go. I wonder if you could just take us through a little bit of your rig that you're going to be using tonight.
I can. Well, first of all, I've got a whammy bar. Look at that. I haven't used a whammy bar for a long time, but I've been having fun with it. Yeah. And it's a, this is actually a custom shop Ibanez. It's really similar to the production one, but it's white.
Yeah.
And I think that shows up a little better.
Definitely. Well, it's like the kind of classic look for you, actually, like back in the early 90s.
Yeah, I used to use these a lot. Really, the only difference with this one is there's no middle pickup.
Yeah.
I found I'd never use it that much anyway. Yeah. If it's there, it's fine, but if it's not, it's fine too.
Yeah.
I can deal with it either way, as long as I've got these two. And the one knob, the one switch, and the whammy. The whammy really stays in tune better because it's got locking tuners. Those are Ibanez ones, and a Wilkinson Goto bridge. And I set it up so the whammy puts it in tune. So if I really bend like crazy, like right now it's pretty much in, but if I bend the B string like just completely insane, like probably go a little bit flat. Not too bad though. And then the whammy puts it back in.
I see.
So, but man, it's doing good.
Yes, and a good looking guitar. Okay, yeah. So unbelievably, actually, that's, we're talking, what, another 26 years for the PGM model, is that correct?
A lot of years. Yeah. Since 1989, I think. Yeah. Something like that.
So could you have envisioned that it would be all, you know, still going all that time, just that one model? It must be one of the longest running signature models.
Yeah, it's, and it's just, it was so simple, just the idea of putting some fake F-holes to hide the volume and the switch.
Yeah.
And it just makes a clean look.
Yeah.
But the guitar itself, I mean, basically an RG, which is just, you know, a guitar that balances well and feels good. And mine's got the big old neck joint on it, so that I think it has a nice
classic
tone from
style,
that.
Yeah.
Well, as long as you get a lot of wood there, you get some sustain.
Can I just ask quickly, because you've got your new record's been out now a couple of months. Okay, I Can Destroy. Go and check it out. Fantastic new album. I love it, actually. How are you finding the fan response? I mean, it's been out a couple of months now. It seems very, very positive.
It's been great. I mean, it might be because I hired a publicist.
Right.
I don't think I ever did that before. And all of a sudden, I was on all the cover of these American guitar magazines, and it almost felt famous.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think hopefully the music has something to do with it, but man, I'm hiring a publicist again. That worked great. I should have done that years ago.
Well, no, it really is a fantastic record. And for myself, listening to Paul Gilbert's music for, it must be another 20 years I've been listening to you. There's quite a few surprises on there on the record. I mean, in terms of, you know, your note choice, phrasing, composition. Was that a deliberate effort to do something a little bit different there?
Well, everything on it was done pretty quickly, from the writing to the recording to the rehearsing, and that's sometimes a really good way to work because you don't have time to mess it up. And a lot of it was written around the lyrics, actually. It was more of a lyric record, and then the guitar stuff was kind of an afterthought. But I've been playing so long that afterthoughts often are the best thoughts, rather than like the record before where I do 70 takes of a solo and then and get myself into some mental wormhole where I didn't know what I was doing. You'd be like, you know, I'd be playing the song and going, I haven't done this solo ever, but it's in E minor and, you know, I'll just do the licks that work in E minor. So it was very much seat of the pants, a lot of improvised stuff, and just had the basic song structures to rely on. But I did, you know, I got to use some of my jazz chords I've been working on. I had an E minor 9 and an A minor 11 for that One Woman Too Many song.
And some great singing on there as well. I noticed you were getting some grit in your voice this time.
It's working for me. I don't know what happened. I think I'm singing more in my range. And so it's just, you know, the what is it called? I am not the one who wants to be with you. You know, it's a little lower part of my range when I sing. And when I do, then I'm not like at the top of my range for the whole song. And, you know, once in a while I can reach up and, you know, just slap a high note.
Sure.
But, you know, it's not the whole tune that way. I'm not trying to be Dio anymore. Not that I ever was, but I'm really not trying to be Dio.
And this record as well, the previous one you put out, mainly covers, was on that.
Yeah.
So this
I lost the will to write.
Right.
And also, I was really interested in learning vocal lines. Mm. I got some great phrases from that. What was that, Steven Tyler? Such a cool line, and then I would take whatever part of that was most friendly for my fingers, that, and turn that into a phrase that I can use when I improvise.
So that
was a great experience, and I was genuinely excited about doing that. But at the time, I just didn't have, you know, my writing mojo wasn't with me, so.
Well, it's back.
But it came back thanks to being stuck in a van and doing an Italian clinic tour. Right. Nothing to do except write lyrics on my, you know, obviously I don't need stone, believe this.
Yeah.
But I had a lot of lyrics, and that makes it easy, gives you a structure.
Yeah. Well, you're touring a lot of the new album and the set, so what have the guys got in store for tonight, like rig-wise? What are you going to be using?
I've got my pedal board, which is a piece of plywood with Velcro on it.
Right. Oh, it's got a name, hasn't it? What is it? Is it not the something?
It's the Superboard 3000. and it's got a shield. I remember having to like write down all the gear for customs,
right,
for a previous tour. And I thought, do I really have to go through my pedal? Like all the, I've Velcroed over all the serial numbers, and plus a lot of times on a tour, I'm changing the pedals anyway throughout the tour. It just seems silly. So I just, you know, made a name for my pedal board. Mm-hmm. I figured that will be the thing I'll check. Mm-hmm. So it became the Superboard 3000.
Okay.
And it's just a piece of plywood. I like the ones with lots of knot holes because that means it's from the top of the tree and it's lighter weight.
Oh, really?
Less likely to get charged, you know, excess baggage at the...
I thought you were joking there for a second. That's just a serious thing. You know?
If you go to the, you know, there's a hardware store near my house that's got all the pieces of wood planks. Mm-hmm. And the knot hole ones are like noticeably lighter in weight.
Right.
Same thing with guitars. I like to, you know, I always ask them, you know, give me the wood from the top of the tree.
Okay.
You know, maybe not the knot holes, but, you know, something that's lighter weight, not compressed from being at the bottom. So a light piece of wood, cover it with Velcro, and then you can stick whatever you want on there. I've got an MXR custom audio buffer. I can sort of... It doesn't have a bypass switch, so I really can't tell the difference between when it's on and when it's off. But people tell me that it's a good idea if you got long cables.
I see.
So I put it in there, and there's room. And from there, I've got an octave pedal, an Octron by Foxvox, which I use for Enemies in Jail, and that just gives me that. That's a mean sound. For that same tune, I turn on my one MXR pedal and go. I got to turn it off for the chord. It only works for single notes.
Right.
But it's got a great sound. From there, I've got the Electric Mistress Flanger, which has that. And I use that for the title track, I Can Destroy. And it also sounds good when you do like a whammy, like. It sort of makes it all growly. Then I've got two MXR Phase 90s, and they're actually identical pedals. They're just, you know, one set fast, wow, 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 and the other one set slow.
You've got the VH1 on there. Is there a reason for that?
It's the sound that Eddie Van Halen used on the first Van Halen album. That's Van Halen 1. You know all that. The brown one, it's hard to see in this light, but it's a TC Electronic Mojo Mojo overdrive pedal, and that's on all the time. And basically the Marshall set really clean, so if I turn that off, that's, you know, I hardly have any distortion on the Marshall at all, and I really get it all from the pedal. And then if I need more distortion, I've got the tube screamer. And there's a delay pedal. I actually met the guy that made this, mm-hmm. and he was really nice. And I've got, I can't remember what it's called because it doesn't have the brand name on it. But I think it's made in the UK,
okay.
and it's labeled sort of like it has something to do with Back to the Future.
I was going
to
say it looks like the flux capacitor.
That's the one. It's the flux capacitor. I can never remember that because I don't know Back to the Future well enough to. But it's a great sounding delay pedal, which is the thing that matters. I leave that on all the time. I just have a real subtle delay, and it's got a view meter. I actually taped over there's a really bright light that comes out of it, mm-hmm. which looked cool, but it was distracting me, so I just put a piece of tape over it. And then the whole thing's powered by it. I should have brought my 220 version for the European tour, but I just bought a Voodoo Labs, pedal power 2 plus, and then I've got a little transformers over there that makes it so I can use the 120 version. If anything, the thing that's probably the biggest change is I try to have one setting where I can stop and leave the volume up and not feed back and have it be completely noisy. Because
right.
that just makes it easier to phrase. I have the option of stopping. If I turn on this pedal, then, you know, with stage volume, you know, then I can't stop. But if I turn it off and it's just have only the Mojo Mojo. Then it's all right. And actually, there's one more pedal. I've got a Keeley Looper, which chooses between this guitar or the guitar that I've got on the stand. And this is these are actually going to come out soon. This is a Ibanez Micro PGM model. Mm. I modified mine, well, it's not much modification, it's 3 strings instead of 6. And they're all tuned to E. And so this pedal, I just switches to this one. And I'll turn this on if I get the thing going. And the thing, this actually came from doing a lick on a normal guitar, but it was really hard to do. And so to make it easier, I tuned all the strings to E. I've got a high E, a middle E, and a low E. And then you can stretch out and get that some kind of, you know, triad arpeggio on all 3 strings without having to move your hand. And you can get these ferocious. Yeah, so that's, it's this glorious shred. And you the open string thing. So I use that for a couple spots in the show.
Tons of fun.
The 3 string. And this guitar is actually a shorter scale. It's a micro, so those kind of stretches are way easier on it. And I've got the same guitar over here set up for slide. So I'm going to put thick strings and raise the action way up, and we do one song with a slide. So that one. And then I've got a fireman, this sort of custom fireman that's mm-hmm. based on a Japanese sake bottle.
Okay.
It's got the bottle caps for the knobs.
Oh, wow.
And it's really good sake. And it made a cool guitar. This is like the thickest neck I've ever felt in my life, which is a little bit hard to play, but it's worth it for the tone.
Sure. I think in the last sort of 10 years or so, you associate you more with that guitar. You know, this
yeah.
is almost like your 90s period, 2000 period, but you've got a nice combination of the pair here.
Well, I probably play half the set with it. So it's I still... And actually, I was a little bit scared to bring this one out because it's I hate to get a dent on it because it's so beautiful.
It's a beautiful
instrument. So I bought some really good cases that have tons of foam, and so it seems to be okay.
One thing that's missing from your rig, I've got to ask about. I don't know whether you can guess what it is.
It was the amp.
No, it's your headphones.
I've been using. I sort of gave up my expectation of ever hearing hi-hat again.
Right.
Because you know the hi-hat's nice to hear because you can keep in time. Yeah. But I finally realized, even with headphones plugged into a monitor thing, and I still don't hear a hi-hat.
Right.
So I thought, why blast all this sound into my head when I'm not going to hear it anyway? Mm-hmm. So basically, I just hear, put earplugs in, and I crank up my voice through the wedge, put some guitar in there, snare and kick, and I just tell the band, You know, if I start speeding up or slowing down, you have to follow me. Right. And it works out great. Hopefully we'll save by hearing more than, because even though I had the headphones to take out the stage volume, I would end up cranking it up inside the headphones to try to hear it, and it's actually, I'm preferring the earplugs.
Right.
The thing that I found is because I don't hear as accurately with everything kind of muffled, I have to know my instrument better.
Right.
And that's a good obligation. You know, rather than doing the thing where I sort of play through the scale and sort of guess by listening, like, well, that's, you know, a scale note, but it's not where I want to land, so I'll move down. I don't do that as much anymore. Now I actually have to learn where to land. And so my fretboard knowledge has increased a lot. Actually, by looking at it, I know where the notes are. And I know what they sound like. That's what I mean. You know, like, I don't have a perfect pitch, so I got to find the key first. But, no. No. It's all, like, I kind of know where they are.
You can feel it out a little bit there as well. You
know? Say again?
You can feel it out a little bit, just kind of from sensation. You can kind of tell where you're going
to
be.
And it's so satisfying as an improviser to actually know what the sound is rather than visually going, well, I know what the shape looks like, so I'll just play and listen as I play and sort of adjust as I go. And then that, you know, you get some good things that way.
Yeah,
but for melodic playing, it's really nice to know, you know, how to go. I gotta find the root. Well, one of the things I found is things that I already did know in my head, but I couldn't play on the first take. For example, the Beatles tune, the second note in that is a fifth, which is a really surprising note. That's because that's a big interval jump. You know, most, if you used to play in scales, you'd go, you know, you'd play like every note in the scale. They skip right over those and go right to the fifth. That's really unusual in terms of guitar technique.
Sure.
But melodically, it sounds great.
It does.
That kind of thing is what I wanted to learn, how to not play from fingers, how to play from what my ear wants to hear.
Just before we jump over to your amps, talking about your knowledge of the fingerboard, all of that, something that you've been a big, you know, played a big part in your life really is also an education, right? Because obviously you tour the world, hit making the songwriter, but you know, your connections with GIT, your classic REH videos, you've done 2,000 video exchanges online.
I've done 4,500 now.
4,500. Where do you see education for guitar going in the future? And, you know, also, do you think that places like GIT or ACM in this country, do you think there's still a place for that in guitar, the guitar world?
Well, I was a student at GIT and I loved it. I mean, it was a long time ago. I'm not sure how different it is now, but I had the best time there. And to me, I mean, certainly it's education, but I'm thinking of it as like saving rock and roll. Because when I see the young kids and how they play and what they don't have in their technique and their playing in their ears, I feel if I can inform them like how to make their guitar sound like rock instead of sounding like a bad harpsichord, I think that's a worthy cause.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm always, I mean, and it's a stylistic thing. I mean, there's great players of every era, but the way that, you know, Segovia, who was a classical player, played, his technique and his tone are going to be really different than Hendrix. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be really different than, I'm trying to think of it. I'm not so fond of the new guys. I don't know them anyway. But to me, I'm sort of like of the Hendrix school, where the thumb is not the classical thumb behind the neck. It's the hanging over the neck, so you can like hit a note and have your hand up here. And not have, you know, not have to be careful, like, you know, that's like the I mean, not that classical players don't play hard, or, but, you know, a lot of like the metal stuff is these guys with the guitar and they're just
Yeah.
They're doing this, and it's
got,
all
got chin rest.
It's all like small motions, and this, you know, rather than be like this, I'd rather be loose and rather. Body and arms, and it just that's the style that is appealing to me, and so I always try to get, you know, and I'm learning too, because I'm a person that's got really big hands, so I can put my thumb over the neck and still get my fingers there, but I mean, Angus Young, little hands, Andy Rhodes, little hands, they rocked. Mm-hmm. It's possible, and if it really is an issue, get one of these little guitars, next small.
Available soon, soon.
Yeah. A PGM Micro, it'll solve all your problems. Yeah, and if you got big hands, man, you can really fly.
Yeah.
So that's the thing with education. I don't want that, the beautiful stuff that I grew up on to be lost. So I'm just sort of an evangelist of like the vibrato of Brian May and Mick Ralphs and Mick Ronson and Jimmy Page and Robin Trower. You know, the guys that were my vibrato heroes. Mm. Of the 70s.
Yeah.
You know, and certainly I teach all the, you know, the quick scale stuff too, but you know, at some point you have to land on a note and end. And if it's a wanky note that just goes it's like having dog shit on your dinner plate. You know, it just ruins the whole thing. So my job is to get a nice clean plate. Mm. Put the good stuff on there, no nothing stinky anywhere, and it's all beautiful.
Perfect. But well,
so I apologize for that rude metaphor.
Oh no, please give us some more. So will we take a look at your amp
yeah, sure,
what's happening?
Yeah. All right, we've got a couple triple Super Lead 100s here. There's a lot of knobs which I'm not using, and I'm just using the clean channel, which you know, I've got the gain about a little over halfway, but again, it's really pretty clean, and just the pedals sort of bring it into rock mode. And I've got the volume down since I don't want to kill you guys here on stage, but I turn it up to about 3. In bigger halls, I might get it up to 4.
Yeah.
on the volume. And you know, it's just simple and reliable. And I try to get the most of the distortion from the pedals, because then if I do a fly date and you never know what kind of Marshall you're going to get, I know that I can get this sound. Mm. You know, if I get a GCM 800 or a 900 or a 2000 or, you know, anything, I can get this sound from it.
Sure.
And I can, you know, get a consistent tone no matter where I go. So I'm that level of artist, at least when I do my solo stuff, where I'm not bringing my own amps. You know, we'll get them from a rental place or, you know, backline company, and these go on the bus every night. So I'm using the same, you know, the heads for this whole leg. But when we do like the shows in Russia or Israel, we'll get local amps, and so I like getting my, you know, the majority of my tone from there, and then just, you know, having the what do they call it, pedal platform, is that the term?
Right. Well, it's the first I've heard it actually, but it's a great term for it.
Maybe, yeah. I don't know if I'm using that term correctly, but anyway, it's just a great basic tone. Mm. That you can sort of get anything from with the right pedals. And of course the classic 412 cabinets, using one head and into both cabinets, and the other head's a spare, which I haven't had to use because this one's been rock solid.
And to make a liar of me, they're here.
I brought these in for sometimes I use them for rehearsal, just because I can, you know, they're easier to take out than earplugs. But I haven't actually used them for anything, so they're just sort of some decoration.
So I know this is all about you know, your solo record and all of that stuff, but it wouldn't be right if I didn't ask you a little bit about Mr. Big.
Mm-hmm.
What's going on there? I understand there's a new record that's potentially coming next year. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, we don't have any dates. Mm. Booked for anything, but we actually did 3 shows recently in California. We played in San Francisco and LA, and we played the kickoff concert for the Monsters of Rock cruise.
Mm.
And it was great. We had like about 3 hours of rehearsal.
Mm.
And you know, we hadn't played together in 2 years, and everything came together great. Mm. So next year we're thinking about doing more shows, maybe some recording.
Mm-hmm.
But it's you know, we'll probably wait wait till the holidays are over and then sort of regroup and figure out what we're going
to
do.
Well, your tour should take you up towards the end of the year anyway. You're pretty fully booked, aren't you, until December, I think that's right, isn't it?
Or what is it again?
I think you're fully booked up till December anyway with the tour. You're going
to... This ends in the middle of November. Mm-hmm. And actually, I have more solo dates in January and February next year, going to South America and Mexico, and we've got some shows in the States. Mm-hmm. So then I've... doing a clinic tour. I actually have to email my manager to find out. So this is at least March or April or something like that. And that's why it's interesting, because I use pickup bands for that. So, you know, it's a guitar clinic. So I talk, you know, I'm talking, you know, I'm not screaming to the crowd going, "All right, let's fucking roll." It's more like, you know, here's a new lick I got, you know, teach a little more. But I also play with local musicians. So every day it's a different drummer, different bass player, and I just, you know, pick some copy tunes or something. And that's a lot of fun, actually, because everybody, you know, to adapt to a different rhythm section every day sort of makes you strong as a musician, stretches you out in a good way.
And about a left field, but from Intense Rock 1, that purple guitar, do you still have it?
Which one?
The purple guitar, I think it was an RG560, maybe, the purple one.
The purple guitar?
Yeah, isn't it purple?
The one with the F-holes, or the...
No, like...
From the instructional video?
Yeah, the very first one.
That one? I gave it to a friend of mine who had done, he put together the Racer X website, and he did it for free. I was like, "Man, that's so cool." And I knew he loved that guitar. So I said, "Man, you know, I appreciate you did this website so much." So I gave it to him. And I said, "Just don't sell it."
Yeah.
He sold it.
And one final thing, I hope Paul doesn't mind me mentioning this, but...
Can you believe that? He sold it.
Yeah, he's going to be celebrating a very special birthday in a couple of days.
That's right.
Now, do you want to tell him, or will I not mention the age? Is that
right? I've got no shame.
Yeah, well, you shouldn't, because he looks about 25. But Paul's going to be 50 in a couple of days' time. You're going to be in Brighton, actually, so make sure you sing happy birthday to him. Looking at the 50-year-old Paul Gilbert, if you could speak to 15-year-old Paul Gilbert sending that demo tape off to Mike Varney all those years ago, what kind of advice would you give 15-year-old you?
Oh, my goodness. Let's see. Maybe don't get a perm. Long is fine, but you know, you don't have to look like Def Leppard. And besides that, there's certain things that I discovered that took me a long time. And one of the things would be that BB King band, where you with your first finger that. And I was always scared of doing that because it actually uses a different part of the skin on your finger, and I never had a callus there. And it's hard to get. I mean, you know, BB and guys like that are on the road 300 nights a year, so calluses become a non-issue because you just get these leather grows on the end of your fingers. But I never had that callus, and I had to work at it. You know, when I finally just got frustrated with myself and was like, "Oh, I got to get that BB bend down." This was, you know, maybe 4 years ago, and I just every day, "Oh, ouch, oh." You know, and then I'd be like, take a break, and then after about 6 weeks, you know, I could finally. And it just revolutionized my vibrato. And so I wish I had started that earlier. And I guess besides that, maybe if I would have decided to like not need the hi-hat earlier and wore earplugs more, that would have been good. But pretty much everything's all right. You know.
Your life's gone all right, hasn't it? Let's face it. It's been a fantastic ride so far, and many, many more to go. Okay, so thanks so much for your time, Paul. The new album, I Can Destroy, it's available iTunes, Amazon, but go to paulgilbert.com for all the info on the album. And
check out my online school, which is, the company's called ArtistWorks. Mm-hmm. And it's got all kinds of teachers, but I'm the rock guitar teacher at ArtistWorks.
Well, straight from Paul's mouth, check out artistworks.com. And thanks so much, Paul, for your time.
Thank you.